All right, welcome back to the channel. Today I'm going to go over what type of firewall should you use as a home user for your computers. Now I'm just going to give you the answer straight away and then I'll dive into all the details in case you just want the answer. I'll just give it to you. Traditional firewalls work just fine. So a traditional firewall, it's anything like Windows Firewall or like if you have an antivirus of some sort or one of those internet security suites, is they'll come with their own firewall. So something like Bitdefender, any kind of security suite should have its own firewall. And then also what you typically get off of a consumer router, typically they have some sort of basic firewall functionality built in. Stuff like that is fine. You don't need to go spend a bunch of money and get like some big fancy piece of enterprise grade hardware or run some complicated setup just to have good protection in your house. Now with that being said, I'm going to go over the differences between each one and kind of how they function. That way you know more about how these devices work. So like I mentioned, an example of a traditional firewall would be something like Windows Firewall. So, I mean, these tend to be pretty basic, and especially like Windows Firewall, you can do quite a bit of stuff with it if you're willing to learn it. Like you can import IP lists and things like that and just block a whole bunch of bad IPs and things like that. Like I've already mentioned, the issue with that is you have to make sure they're constantly updated because those lists are always changing. You can do quite a bit with just a basic firewall. And for the vast majority of home users, a basic firewall, like I said, it's really all you need. And another example of a firewall would be something like IP tables. If you're a Linux user, you've probably used IP tables at some point or used something that interfaced with IP tables. So let's dive into how these actually work. Now, the first thing that these traditional firewalls do is they use something called packet filtering. Now, this is... So you have your source and destination, which are pretty self-explanatory. So you have where the traffic's coming from, where the traffic is going to, and then it also takes a look at the protocol as well. And by using packet filtering, is the firewall is able to determine, okay, these packets should be going to this destination. These packets should not be going to this destination. Something's wrong. The protocol isn't right for what's going on here. Things of that nature. It's somewhat basic. And just about every firewall out there does that kind of stuff. Now, they can also do something called stateful inspection. And I will cover this more in stateful versus stateless firewalls that would need to get a video all in its own. But to give you a really basic overview of that is it uses, basically it's like dynamic packet filtering. So it takes a look at the context of the connection. So using something called state tables. And so it's taking a look at things like, okay, this user is interacting with a website, there's data going back and forth between these two, and if you had a third party trying to inject traffic, is a stateful firewall because it's aware of the context of the connection. What's going on is it's like, oh, okay, well, this traffic is not good. This is not supposed to be part of the communication between this user and the server or whatever the case is. So stateful inspection can be pretty useful. Now the other thing, and this might have kind of deserved its own thing up here where I was talking about firewalls, but this is something I just decided to put down here instead. It's something called a proxy firewall, and I've made some videos about this before. So this would be things like DNS, and I made a video a while back, I think it was a few months ago at this point, talking about how you can use DNS to prevent yourself from being hacked. And so here's what I mean by that. So I've talked about services like NextDNS, Control-D, DNS0, Quad9, all that kind of stuff. So I've got the DNS0 website pulled up here. And there's all these configuration settings for how to set it up on each of your devices or if you want to set it up on your router. And it has things like, okay, well, you've got privacy, security, and encryption on your DNS traffic. Super important. You're not really truly gaining any privacy by using encrypted DNS, but it does protect you against some types of DNS attacks. But the big benefit with using services like this is that you are able to protect yourself against a bunch of malware-laden websites. And so these DNS services work with threat intelligence providers to say, okay, well, we have this list of websites that are known to be malicious, then you can use that DNS service to block those out. And I know this isn't really like truly a proxy firewall, so to speak, but it kind of works like one. Another example would be something like a VPN. A lot of VPN services these days have the ability to block malware, block trackers, things like that. Some of the services that I've looked at, you can pull up like a list of a block list of things like an OISD list, for example, where you can block out known threats by using VPNs. And I know some people might have watched my video a while back talking about VPNs, and no, I'm not against VPNs. In fact, I think they do have their uses. Some of the marketing for them has been pretty atrocious, and they try to trump these things up to be something that they're really not. And a proxy firewall can also do things like hide your IP from the server. So here's what that would look like. And so let's look at this from the context of SOX 5, which is one of the ways that you can hide your IP from a server. And I realize, again, this stuff is all kind of context dependent, especially on how you set things up. Like, okay, are you going to run a VPN and then use SOX 5? So you could use something like you as the user here, this is your computer. Then your traffic goes through and gets routed through a SOX 5 proxy, which then goes to the ClearNet. And then you can also do things like insert a VPN in here, and you can either insert the VPN before or after the SOX 5 proxy. That's going to kind of get out of the purview of this video, so I'm not going to get super in-depth on that. But one of the most important things to keep in mind with these is that these can block threats before they even reach your computer. So like on some of these traditional firewalls, like Windows Firewall, for example, it's having to block it as it's coming to your computer. Whereas if you use something like Quad9 or DNS0 or something like that, if you accidentally click on a malware-laden website, there's the chance that as long as it's in their block list, it will block it before it can even have the chance to reach your computer and potentially make it past your computer's antivirus. So these kind of services are actually pretty useful. I like running with encrypted DNS, VPN. Kind of depends on what you want to use it for, but that's certainly an option as well that you could kind of look at it. Again, it's context dependent, but you can kind of look at it as being a firewall of sorts. Now, there are some key weaknesses if you are going to be using a traditional firewall. First thing is it lacks any sort of an intrusion prevention system and deep packet inspection. So when I say IPS, I broke this down in a video. I'll just give you a brief explanation. You can go watch the previous video talking about IPS if you want a full breakdown of this. But you can do things like signature-based detection, anomaly-based detection, and stateful protocol analysis, where it can detect threats as it's coming into your network. And the thing with DPI, because a lot of traffic these days is encrypted, is if you don't have deep packet inspection, which has the ability, as long as it's set up properly, the ability to decrypt traffic coming through the internet to look and see if any of the packets are malicious. If you don't have that, you won't be able to see any of the encrypted traffic coming through, if whether or not it's malicious before it makes it to your computer. There's also things like packet filter bypassing. So this can be things like fragmentation attacks, IP spoofing, port hijacking, and there's a handful of other attacks that can also allow attackers to bypass a packet filter. And then the other thing that comes into play here, if I can get my screen to work well here, is poor app awareness. And what I mean by that is being able to track individual apps, the traffic that they're sending back and forth, and to be able to tell what app is doing what specifically. So that's a pretty basic overview of how traditional firewalls work. Let's go ahead and talk about how next-gen firewalls work, and should you have one as a home user. So two common examples of this, there's quite a few different examples out there. An open source option, if you want one, is OpenSense. And a closed source option, if you want something that, I mean, it works really well. OpenSense is really my preference, but Sophos XG Home Edition is a firewall that you load onto a computer, just how you would something like pfSense or OpenSense. You need to have basically like a dedicated computer be able to run this, so you need to have like your networking cards and all that kind of stuff. So it does take some dedicated hardware to be able to run it. But let's go ahead and go through how this stuff works. So first thing, I know I've already kind of talked about this a little bit, is you have deep packet inspection, which means you can analyze encrypted traffic that's coming through your system. Now that's, as, like I said, that's as long as it's set up properly. So you need to have your certificate set up properly in order to decrypt any traffic coming through. There is some slight security risk if you are going to be using this, but overall, like especially for home users, you don't need to worry about this. I'm just going to throw this out there. You don't need to worry about all this stuff as home users, running like deep packet inspection, IPS, if you don't want to. If you just want to learn about computers, which for a home user is great. I mean, you should always be learning about technology, because technology is taking over people's lives, and the more you know about it, the better equipped you're going to be. This is really useful and basically necessary for things like enterprise and government environments, where they need to see all of the encrypted traffic coming to and from in order to make sure everything is good. Now, the other thing with next-gen firewalls, if I can make my arrow work right here, is things like identity awareness. Now, this comes into play as to like who is accessing the internet and what is the minimum level of access that they really need to have. So like in an IT environment is when you set a computer up is, okay, what does this user need to have access to? What do they not need to have access to? Let's remove the things that they don't need to have access to. And if you've ever noticed this, this is really common in big businesses and government because of the risk of security leaks and things like that. You'll see this a lot. And if you work in IT, you probably don't watch my videos because my videos are geared more towards home users. But hey, maybe you're looking at getting into IT. The other thing with next-gen firewalls, again, this is more of a enterprise user, is being able to do things like app control. So let's say you wanted apps like, well, I know it's not necessarily an app, this is a website, but let's just say Google.com you wanted to allow, but TikTok you want to disallow. So you can block certain things from the network, but allow other things. So the other thing with that is you also get granular activity visibility. So I mentioned this a little bit, is a con of a traditional firewall, is you can't see like the granular activity. So like traffic going to and from specific apps, you try and pull that up in something like Windows Firewall, for example, it just won't work. Whereas like, let's say you have a Cisco firewall or something like that, you're going to be able to see every little thing that's going on as long as you set it up and you want to be able to see that kind of stuff. The other thing is you also get access to, not with all of them, but you can do it with some of them, is remote access VPNs. This kind of comes down more, so like you would need to have this set up like at the router level. So let's say something like OpenSense or an enterprise piece of hardware, like Fortinet or something like that. So this is something, it's different than a regular VPN. So when most people think of VPNs, they think of an application that they're running on their computer. So there's a few out there, like Mulvad is a really popular one. It's one of the two or three that I actually recommend if you're going to use a VPN. I think they're reliable and trustworthy. And so most people think of VPNs as being like this app that they run. But there's actually other stuff though, because what you can do with VPNs and also how you'd set it up on like a business environment would be something similar to this actually as well. So let me kind of just walk you through this. So let's say you have an OpenSense router and you want to set up your own private access VPN. What you can do is set your phone up to be able to connect to your home router first. So your phone's connection goes to the home router. The home router acts as your VPN, which then accesses the internet, like some server or website or whatever it is. Then that traffic goes back through the home router, so that traffic goes through deep packet inspection. If you have it set up, it goes through an IPS, DNS filtering. Then that traffic goes back to your phone. This is actually really handy. Now, you can just use a regular VPN app. If you use a good one like Mulvad, I think Mulvad has the option to be able to select like block lists, like an OISD list, for example, where you can just block a predetermined list of threats, kind of like how you would do with DNS filtering. But if you wanted to set up a remote access VPN, you could do something like this if you want to. That's another nice option with these. The other thing I've already talked about this a little bit, and again, I broke it down in the video. I think it was the two videos ago talking about IPS in depth. You, with intrusion prevention systems, this is an automated way to block threats that the machine detects on your network. So it works off of things like signature-based threats, so something that there's already a signature for. So this is pre-existing malware that these threat intelligence providers have assigned a signature to. Then you have things like anomaly-based detection and stateful protocol, which comes in handy when you have things like zero-day threats that are trying to get into your network, and you need to have some sort of heuristics for the intrusion prevention system to be able to think, okay, This is how this user normally interacts with the internet. We're seeing this kind of traffic coming through. Something's not quite right here. Let's block it. So having the intrusion prevention system is pretty handy. Like I said, for business and government, this stuff is really important. For home users, I really don't think you need to worry about it. But like I said, if you want to set this up on your home systems for fun, be my guest. I figure a lot of people that watch my stuff, and especially from the comments, I can tell a lot of people just do this stuff for fun at home to be able to learn more about tech, which, like I said, I recommend you do it because the world is going to be run by those who know how to operate tech, especially in the next 5 to 10 years, and really when AI takes over, those who know tech are going to be in a much better leverage position than those who don't. It's kind of a video all in and of itself that I could make. I think a lot of people that watch my channel can get where I'm going with that. And then the last thing is threat intel feeds. So these are pretty handy. Some routers or firewalls have this stuff built in and will automatically update and allow you to select lists, and some you might have to download manually. So for example, one of the things that I would consider to be a firewall, maybe some people would disagree with me, is CrowdSec. Now you can go look at it. Hopefully they will make it a easier system to adopt. I'm gonna make a video at some point on how to set it up on Windows, because I think CrowdSec is really nice for home users. It's free for home users. They use things like threat intel feeds, which would be things like, okay, there's all these people that are having issues with this IP address. Let's add this to a list rolled out to all of our users. And then you have things like threat intelligence groups that gather data on malicious activity, malicious actors, hackers, things like that. And then they distribute their feeds out to other people. So this comes in the form of things like block lists. So you can find open source block lists, things that you can just download and use for free, on places like GitHub. And an example of another one with your own dedicated website is OISD. There's a ton of threat intel feeds that you can use on your firewall, depending on how you want to set it up. It's really up to the user. So that is basically a pretty good high level overview of traditional versus next gen firewalls. I could really make long videos talking about just each one of these in depth, going over this stuff. But again, I'm trying to cut down on my videos and keep them from being like regularly 35, 45 minutes long, and try to shorten them down a little bit so you're not watching super long videos. Anyway, that's going to wrap the video up. If there's anything in particular you would like to see, or if you want something clarified on this, just drop a comment, let me know. Be happy to answer any questions, or if there's particular videos that you would like to see made, also just go ahead and let me know. I've already got the next about 6 months of content planned out. I'm still going to keep, for the foreseeable future, Mondays and Fridays are still going to be the upload days for my videos. And so as long as I stick to that 2 videos a week, I already have like the next 6 months of content planned out. These videos take quite a bit of time to make. And so that's why I'm trying to cut down some of the unnecessary stuff in these videos a little bit, because some of them kind of drag on a little too long. But if you guys want to see like a really in-depth tutorial, there's some of the stuff that I'm making, like intro to PowerShell, like PowerShell for home users, bash scripting for home users. Those are gonna be pretty long and pretty in-depth. I'm putting in a lot of work on like those 2 videos specifically. I'm putting in a lot of work on those. So those are still gonna be a ways away, because I have to figure out how I'm gonna make it applicable to home users to use things like PowerShell. But again, if you want to see anything in particular, just let me know. And with all that being said, I appreciate the support as always. Thank you for watching, and for the 2 people that are left watching to this point in the video, I will see you on Friday.